So as mentioned, I'm Alexis Palou, Business Development Senior Manager here at TriLink, and I am in charge of supporting our European customer on their path from R&D to clinical phase mRNA production. So I would like to welcome everyone to our talk in which we will discuss ideas and practices for optimizing your mRNA construct for efficacy and stability, as well as giving a sneak peek at some of TriLink's upcoming offerings. Here's the overall agenda for today's talk. So first, we'll start with some of the basics. We want to cover the overall structure of an mRNA and how it is currently being used as a therapeutic tool. From there, we will discuss chemical modifications that can improve the efficacy of your mRNA. Specifically, we're looking at mRNA nucleotide modifications that can be incorporated into the in vitro transcription reaction. This is often the easiest and most cost-effective way to improve the efficacy of your mRNA, and we'll discuss the modality of this. And we will cover some in vivo efficacy data in project using modified uridine to show that this is not only a benchtop phenomenon. And then lastly, we will go over a sneak peek of TriLink's current and upcoming modified uridine offerings. So here you see the standard structure of a viable mRNA. This includes a 5' cap, a 5' UTR region, and the coding sequence for the target protein, a 3' UTR region, a polyethyl, and each part is integral for proper protein expression of your target gene. So starting with the 5' cap. So this region is the main recognition site by the ribosome for initiation of translation. One important point is using a naturally occurring cap structure, known as a cap-1 structure, is very important when creating a viable mRNA. This structure will be recognized as self by the cells, ribosome, and immune system, and will aid in active translation of your protein. Other cap structures, such as cap-0, are often recognized as foreign by the cell's immune factors causing degradation, leading to significantly lower levels of expression. TriLink uses transcriptional cap analog, CleanCap, to create a naturally occurring 5' cap-1 structure without the use of post-IVT enzymatic reaction. The 5' UTR is not translated into protein, but does aid in the overall expression of your mRNA, as it contains the COSAC sequence that function as the protein translation initiation site. Having a 5' UTR that contains a strong COSAC sequence can significantly increase levels of expression of your target protein. Your coding region, the CDS, contains the genetic sequence of your target protein. This is the area of the mRNA that will be translated by the ribosome. There are several ways you can code and optimize your coding region to allow for a more efficient and effective translation of your protein. Some of these include optimizing for your specific target, and depleting the sequence of uridine contact. So optimizing your CDS is important and can also significantly affect downstream efficacy of your mRNA. The 3' UTR and polyethyl mainly aid in stability of your mRNA when introduced to the cell. So as you can see in this diagram, proteins bind 5' cap and polyethyl of the mRNA together to initiate translation by the ribosome. The polyethyl act as a sort of timer for the translation of the protein. When bound to the ribosome, it is being deadenylated by enzymes in the cell, and when it is completely chewed up, the mRNA becomes significantly less stable, altering connection to the ribosome and the efficiency of translation. So, knowing that, we know that mRNA has proven to be a unique therapeutic modality of many reasons. First and foremost, mRNA has proven to be a safe therapeutic option as mRNA transiently expresses the target protein. There's no gene integration or worry for downstream genetic side effects. This allows for a robust platform of protein production by mRNA that is unattainable by other drug or therapeutic methods. So mRNA gets to work quickly. The drug substance does not need to enter the nucleus of the cell and in fact translate the protein immediately in the cytoplasm. The longevity of expression of your mRNA is normally quite short-lived. It translates the protein efficiently, acting fast enough to avoid long-term issues with stability or safety. Lastly, mRNA is easy to manufacture via an in vitro transcription reaction. This can be done at small R&D scale on a benchtop, and the same process is easily transferable to larger clinical scale in a bioreactor. This is different from traditional viral or antibody-based therapeutics that use a cell in production, and we normally do not see complex structures such as protein folding or disulfide bonding noticed in other therapeutic modalities. The main struggle in production, though, is surrounding purification. mRNA has proven to be an extremely delicate molecule that often degrades under high pressures or heats required for some traditional forms of purification. Thus, optimizing both the IVT reaction to produce the cleanest possible mRNA and optimizing the purification of the mRNA to avoid degradation becomes extremely important when planning a roadmap from the benchtop production of the mRNA to the clinic. Okay, now that we have covered some of the basics, let's move on to ways to optimize your mRNA construct. The first and foremost used method for optimization are chemical modification to improve efficacy. One of the easiest ways to aid in immune response mitigation is the use of modified bases, specifically modified uridine. While DAB uridines can trigger immune responses when introduced to the cell, this can lead to degradation by intracellular organelles, limiting the longevity and efficiency of protein expression. Modifying NTPs can reduce the binding to innate immune sensor during in vitro application. There is evidence that they can reduce toxicity, leading to prolonged expression in cultured cells. Not only has this effect been seen in vitro, but it does translate to in vivo application as well, where modified NTPs can lead to sustained expression of the target protein. The most popular modified uridines are N1-methylpseudouridine, currently used in both mRNA COVID-19 vaccines, 5-methoxyuridine, and pseudouridine. Each can provide therapeutic benefits, but the most widely used and effective has proven to be N1-methylpseudouridine. The capping reaction is absolutely necessary, as uncapped mRNA has a 5' triphosphate group present that may stimulate the immune response, leading to degradation of the mRNA. Additionally, uncapped mRNAs will not bind properly to the ribosome, inhibiting protein production. So this sets up common pitfalls, but what has been the solution here at TriLink? So we have found to be most effective are the use of clean cap and N1-methylpseudouridine in the production of the mRNA. So on the left, you can see the full naturally occurring cap1 structure provided by clean cap, and on the right, you can see the N1-methylpseudouridine structure. These both take the place of classic production of mRNA using a post-IVT capping reaction and wild-type bases. Both are simple changes that can be made during the IVT reaction that can prove to be very beneficial to the efficacy of the mRNA. So how did we get there? Well, the early work was pioneered by scientists many of you will recognize, Dr. Carrico and Wiseman out of the University of Pennsylvania in the mid-2000s. The inceptual paper in 2008 describes how N1-methylpseudouridine modified mRNA is able to evade recognition by toll-like receptor in the cell. This was a significant breakthrough in the field of mRNA therapeutics. Further work done by these two showed that not only was the modified mRNA able to avoid the toll-like receptor in the cells, but that the translational capacity of these modified mRNA was drastically increased. This allowed for further stability of the fragile mRNA molecule when introduced to the cell, again leading to significantly higher levels of expression. Further work has been done on this, showing that N1-methylpseudouridine specifically enhances translation by increasing ribosome density. So very briefly, this figure really sums up how well designed mRNAs are able to avoid the intracellular roadblocks put up by the immune system. Cap1 structure and modified uridine enable mRNA to evade the cell's innate immune response when delivered to the cell. So now let's get into some in vitro efficacy data of modified mRNA. This slide depicts GFP fluorescence in multiple cell lines. In each case, the GFP has been synthesized with a different modified nucleotide. So you can see that the modified uridine all perform quite well, most notably against their wild-type counterparts, as well as other modified nucleotides. Again, showing evidence that modified uridines can play a significant role in mitigating the innate immune activation often seen when using wild-type uridine. One final approach here for optimization, and not necessarily related to modified bases, is surrounding uridine depletion. Given the evidence that innate immune activity may be linked to uridine content, another way to limit an immune response is to canon optimize your sequence to deplete for uridine content. So here, the experiment shows the difference in protein activity between a standard luciferase sequence with modifications to a uridine-depleted luciferase sequence. As a secondary measure, it compares modified nucleotides in each case as well. So in each case, uridine depletion of the luciferase sequence shows higher levels of luciferase activity. When paired with a base modification, specifically modified uridine, you can see that the expression increases even more. So the takeaway message here is that when performed in tandem with modified base usage, uridine depletion significantly improves protein functionality. So as a quick summary, here are the main takeaways to consider when thinking about using modified bases for your mRNA production. So chemical modifications are a simple way to design your mRNA to help mitigate innate immune activity. Uridine content has shown to cause immune activation. Canon optimizing to uridine deplete your sequence is also a great way to aid in immune suppression. But lastly, it is important to note that different cell line or system may require different optimization techniques to aid the immune response. Now, we can discuss some in vivo data TriLink has collected surrounding modified base usage. So as previously mentioned, strategies to reduce the innate immune response of the mRNA can work in vivo settings. So here we compare LNP package luciferase mRNA with both Cap1 and Cap0 mRNA, as well as different purification and modification strategies. Luciferase level in mouse liver cells were then measured at 6 and 24 hours post-transcription. So as you can see, the CAP strategy and modification play a significant role in luciferase expression. Samples performed best that had the 5-methoxyuridine modification and Cap1 structure. We were able to see a strong fluorescent signal in this category, even 24 hours post-transcription. Next came the HPLC-purified mRNA using wild-type bases and the Cap1 structure. So the main takeaway here is that chemical modifications used in the IVT reaction, so Cap1 structure and 5-methoxyuridine, significantly aided in protein expression. And last but not least, TriLink has recently expanded its offering to enable companies that are ready for both clinical grade and scale production of their mRNA. So the first necessary change we underwent was to expand our production capabilities to provide clean cap for COVID-19 vaccine, setting up a framework for mass production of other nucleotides as well. In fact, at the end of 2019, TriLink had the capacity to produce in the gram per month range for CleanCap. Right around this time, the COVID-19 pandemic required urgent demand for the reagent at mass quantities for several companies. So to meet this request, we scaled up our operations to continuously produce CleanCap into several kilogram quantity per month. To do this, we built a new ISO manufacturing space. We developed new analytical methods and optimize the synthesis for yield and quality. Based on our successful CleanCap manufacturing scaling up, we are confident that this procedure would be transferable to a modified NTP production, as well as allow us to scale GMP manufacturing of our modified nucleotide to commercial scales. And finally, here's a look at what is to come for the coming year. Anyway, I would like to conclude quickly that, as you know, that mRNA has emerged as a safe and rapid and effective therapeutic option across multiple disease indication. So several optimization strategies, including modifying nucleotides and streamlining production, can prove to be very effective for your application. And we've seen that modified uridine is one of the leading contributors to the success of mRNA programs. And as I said, TriLink has scaled up and is currently scaling up our GMP offering to include all these modified nucleotides. So a few final words here. That we not only provide GMP reagent, but we also provide CDMO services from R&D grid up to clinical phase one GMP material. And And we have here you can see our facility that we've built up recently that you can that we can provide you for your need. So we've moved into this facility in the beginning of 2020 and was specifically designed for manufacturing. We have ISO class 7 and ISO class 8 GMP suites with class 5 fill and finish hoods. And in total, we have 15 suites for our different GMP manufacturing progress program. So this is a very brief summary of offering, but I will not go into detail about this because for the sake of time. And if you have further questions, whether about our reagents or manufacturing services, please feel free to contact us and we'll get you in touch with our manufacturing experts. And with that, I would like to thank you and conclude this talk. And I'm happy to take any question you might have.
Thank you, Alexandre. So we have time for one question. Maybe a second one, but you need to be short in the answer. So the first one is, any comment on the performance of N1 methyl pseudo UTP dissolved in Na plus O2 solution and any data to support?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question? I didn't get the last part of your question.
any comment on the performance of N1 methyl pseudo UTP dissolved
Yeah, so in general, what we observed in our experiment with our customers that N1 metal CU has been very efficient. But again, this is very system dependent. So usually what we recommend is to try either to try out N1 metal CU versus other modified uridines and head-to-head trail with your research grade material set to see which one will provide you the best expression results. But again, the literature has shown us that really N1 metal CU has proved to be very efficient for protein expression cells. But I really would like to highlight the fact that it can be very system dependent.
Okay, and so a second one, are there any advantage of using a phosphorothioate backbone over phosphodiester linked nucleotides in mRNA for translation efficiency and immune evasion?
It's a good question. And I believe from what we've seen with our customer, this is something that has to be addressed depending on the target cell and target tissue. So this is not a general answer I can give. It's really so we usually recommend our customer to make a screening with different strategic approach, including this topic, but also the different nucleotides that we provide, because you cannot really draw a generic solution because of the difference in the application. So this is it's not a straightforward answer. Yeah. Would be my answer.